Thanks, Bill. I want to introduce other people who are responsible for putting these meetings together also. And Gail Horbath is the Secretary Treasurer of Navesink Maritime. And Rick Van Hemmen, who's our Vice President, is in the back, right here by the pole. Okay. And Tom Gibson is here somewhere in the room, who's also works with us in the restoration of the Garvey and the reproduction for the New Jersey Friends of Clearwater. And Michael Humphreys, who's our publicist, is where? Right there, standing on the pole. Okay. I hope I haven't forgotten any of our committee. These are the board members who are responsible for organizing this event. And Barbara Ladulis, my significant other here, as with Amy and with some people who couldn't be here, Gloria and Irene, have assembled some of the refreshments. So I'm going to turn the meeting over now to begin with our first speaker, and that's Greg Strand, who is historian for the North Shrewsbury Iceboat and Yacht Club, correct? All right, Greg.
X marks the spot. I've never used a mic before. Okay. Can you hear me good? All right. First of all, I want to thank about 8 gentlemen from Red Bank, the merchants that put on the Iceboat Club over here, and they finally got together. They knew how wonderful this river was in soft water sailing, so they wanted to do ice boating. And they were very wealthy individuals, and they made that Iceboat Club over here in 1880. And I want to thank them, because without them, we would never have the great Iceboat Club that we have here, and everything on the Red Bank River is for ice boating. As you do know, the symbol for Red Bank on all the police car doors and on the center of town is an ice boat. That is a boat called the Scud, which was our famous boat. Oh, sit in the spot. Okay, let me tell you a little bit about myself. I've been an ice boater for a long time. I had my first ride when I was 10 years old on the South Shrewsbury River. And ironically, on that particular first ride, we fell through the ice and I had to walk home. But it didn't deter me from loving this sport, and I got to see the big A boats on the Long Branch River. I joined, after sailing there for my early youth, I grew up with a man who owned an ice boat. He was an Olympic ice skater, so I had an ice boat at my disposal. So in 1967, I believe, the Iceboat Club over here had run on some hard times. A lot of the people had died off, boats were in storage, and they had an auction. They put 16 boats out in the parking lot to buy. And I walked in as a 17-year-old boy, and I fell in love with a boat that I wanted. And these older individuals came over to me and said, you don't want that boat. Take this boat over here. And I said, why? Why should I take that one? Because we're going to pay for it with you. We'll help you afford it. So I was able to buy a boat, which was a Marconi rigged ice boat. Marconis were the cream of the crop in the day. They came out in the late 30s and were made. But there was a method to their reasoning here, because they only had 2 other Marconis that were actively sailing, and they needed a third one. So I happened to be the guy that they stuck with buying that boat. But I ended up making it run really good, and I was a champ. The boat was a champ for many, many years. But in campaigning it, I decided to join the Hudson River Iceboat Club about 1970. And I just want to thank John Spurr over here. He's a member of the Hudson Club. He came down. He has his own website on ice boating, and he's a great sailor. And I'm glad that he came down here to our talk today. And that's fabulous. But he's been a real force up there in the Hudson for the ice boating. So joining their club in 1970, I then went to Orange Lake, and I helped on rebuilding the Jack Frost in 1973 through 75, which is a 49-foot, almost 50-foot long ice boat that was very, very famous, owned by Archibald Rogers, who was the president of Standard Oil Company in the day up on in and around the Hudson River by Hyde Park. Consequently, right after that, I joined the Long Branch Ice Boat and Yacht Club. And they were wonderful. The old timers, they had the same situation where they weren't using their boats too much. So they had a group of people that was a splinter group that broke off from the regular club, but they were strictly sailing the stern steerers, the big 30 footers. And so they took me under their wing. So I got a lot of knowledge from those guys, a lot of knowledge from the early guys from the Hudson who revived the sport of ice boating, Ray Ruge in particular. He was a force in 1964. He decided to bring ice boating alive, because it had been so dormant. And with that growth, we had the growth down here. I've restored about 14 of the big A boats myself and owned them and sailed them. And I enjoy the sport, it's my passion. The big boats are my passion. And now with the rocket, the finishing of the rocket, it was something I really enjoyed. I helped get the cockpit out from under our club to look at it, to make a replica of half scale. And then I brought it back to the club and decided we're gonna do the full thing. And the men, John Holian and Bob Pulch, thank God Bob over there, spearheaded everything with John Holian. And the rocket became what it is today, and it was done on a 10-year restoration, and it sailed on March 1st for the first outing of this year. But it was built in 1888, and it hadn't been on the ice in probably 100 years. It was stored under the Iceboat Club. Another person I'd like to thank was John Darling, who was our custodial member of our Iceboat Club. He took care of the remaining parts of that rocket under that club, meticulously going under and making sure that whatever was left there stayed in good shape. And he was our member for about 50-some years, and a tremendous a guy. And we have a race that we run out here called the John Darling Memorial Race. Those are some of the people here. I want to just tell you, people that don't know much about ice boating, how it all started. You know, as you do know, the Dutch settlers came here to the Hudson Valley, and they brought with them the sport of ice boating. And around the 1700s, Their deal was to take a boat and just put a plank under a regular soft water boat and then put two runners on the end of the port and starboard, and on the big barn door tiller that they sailed the boat with, they would put a piece of steel underneath there and they would sail on the Hudson River doing that. And then as time went on, that was around 1700. Time went on, things had to change up because it wasn't really going to perform very well. And so a guy named Oliver Booth up there made a boat that was more or less a box, and he put the rudder in the box, and the mast was in the box, and he had a jib off the front. Obviously, it was a forerunner thing, and it didn't really go good either, but he was progressing along. So things got better and better, and more people were experimenting with it. And of course, speed is your biggest thing. They want performance and speed, and they weren't going to get it too much with that thing. So along came the side railer boat, which was, I have some pictures of the side railers here. I don't know if you can see some of them. You can see them reared up here. The cockpit was in the back, but it was big timbers that went out to a runner plank, and they were very rigid. And they had for ballast, they used to have to put people out on the runner plank, and they were paid a meager fee of $1 a day. To risk their lives out on that runner plank to keep them from hiking up. And things were pretty stiff. Everything in those days was the stiffer the better, because they would go out in any kind of wind condition, especially on the Hudson River. And with all the ice that was chunked up and the hummocks and stuff like that, whatever they would hit, they needed something very strong. They even used a steel rod to hold them in later dates, from the bow to the stern to the ends of the runner plank to keep them square. That was after the side railer. Side railer was all wood construction. And the mast was placed right over top of the runner plank. And some of those pictures, you may see it, particularly being over the runner plank like that, they did not know that what it did to the performance of the boat. They thought the more sail you could put on a boat, the better it was going to be. But what happened is the force of effort and the force of resistance. The force of resistance is the runner plank itself on the boat. The force of effort's in the sail. And they were right over opposing each other. And the boat was like a teeter-totter. And then it would spin. And in the back end, there would be too much leeward pressure on the tiller. And the boat would slide out, or we call it a flicker. And they would reverse itself, do a 180-degree spin, and throw everybody off. So as they started experimenting more, about 1871, somebody, Captain Rollier out of Athens, I believe.
Hold on one sec. Sorry.
Go. Anyhow, this Captain Rollier built a boat called the Great Scott, and in return, he didn't use the side rails on this particular boat. I got this all right, John. I think I do. So he used a long keel out of one piece of wood, and then he had the runner plank, and he used cables and did away with the side rail construction
and that gave it all the weight, and he put cables on to hold it in, almost like a kite would be made together. And then away this thing would go. And they decided at that time to move the mast off of the runner plank and move it forward 3 feet. And what that did was put the center of effort back a little bit further on the boat. They shortened the jib in the front. Originally, these boats had so much sail, they were way out the front, way out the back, and now he's made a balanced boat out of it, and that took off, and away it went for the future construction of those boats. And the controllability was there, and so the speeds came up.
About what year was that?
About in 1871, I think, it was up there. The first ice boats are going back, you know, I got to bounce around, and it's all up in my head, right? So. A guy named Percy Ashley was a guy who was very big on ice boat designs, and he was thinking this stuff up late 1700s, and he made a lot of designs, and a lot of the boats eventually went to his design, but a lot of them went to the design of the Great Scott, I believe. And but anyhow, make a long story short, they got better and better and better. So right around the Civil War, a lot of people in our country made some major freight money, and they decided that they were going to get into the sport big and heavy. And all through the Hudson Valley, money was no object for building the boats. And a lot of the boats were just gorgeous. And this fellow by the name of Irving Grinnell, he was a commodore of the New Hamburg Club. He built a boat called the Whiff, and the Whiff was 40 feet long, and it was a side railer, and it was built specifically for the Philadelphia Exposition in 1876. And the workmanship was incredible. It had a lot of walnut on it, and white pine, and they had a relief etching of a dragon on it, with the wings of a dragon. The boat was beautiful. The boat exists today. It's owned by the Hudson River Club, but it's on display at the Kingston Maritime Museum.
It's in a barn, right?
Oh, it is in a barn? Okay.
That's the
icicle. Yeah, the icicle's up there, too. I thought the whiff was there, too. Yeah. But anyhow, this boat blew everything out of the water, but it was a side railer. It was still something that nobody had really seen before, but the Philadelphia Exposition people came in droves. They saw the boat. They saw the introduction to ice boating, and they went crazy. And they all started building ice boats, and it spread from the Hudson Valley down here. We were still experimenting too here, but the better boats were starting to come here. They went to the Ohio, up to Canada, out to Michigan, Wisconsin. It just blew up. And at one time, I think Frank Leslie's cassette at one time in 1866 prior to this said there was about 100 boats on the Hudson River. But once this boat took on, everybody was excited and they were building the boats. But going back to the wealth that came by, after the exposition, people started building bigger and better boats. The America's Cup technology started to take hold in the 1880s, and that was the heyday of ice boating in our country, especially along the Hudson. You had the very wealthy up there. Archibald Rogers was he lived two doors away from the Roosevelts. John Roosevelt, which is the uncle to Theodore Roosevelt. John Roosevelt had the Icicle. The first Icicle was built in 1879. She was 68 feet 10 inches long, carried 1,070 square feet of sail. And this boat was horrendous and very, very big. And it took a big crew to do it. But again, she was of the old design. And that boat in 1871 supposedly raced against the Chicago Express, which is now the Amtrak Railroad, going down the east side of the Hudson River, and from Poughkeepsie to Ossining, beat the train. But I heard stories that the train stopped a couple times, but I don't know, to pick up passengers. But I don't know. But I can't see a boat of that size going faster than 40 or 50 miles an hour, but they would go out in a gale. And the best thing about the Hudson River, it's north and south, and you get a northwest wind, you're on a broad reach going up, and the same thing coming back, you're going to hit the maximum speeds. And you can go, I think they were traveling from Poughkeepsie to Hamburg, 7 miles or 9 miles, I forget how big it is. But once you get a boat going, you know, it's awesome, because the ice boat runners are so sharp and so much weight on board, that the force of the wind on a broad reach is going to get you going pretty fast, two or three times the speed of the wind. And then the runners are digging in, so it's giving that force forward, and it's got lift on board, you know, to get the boat to go faster. So you can get great speeds by doing that. When you sail different kinds of courses, you're not going to get that kind of speed, especially the courses that we have down here. Okay, so money was no object when they built those boats in the 1880s. They had the new icicle that came out, which John was just talking about, is at the Kingston Maritime Museum. And she, I believe, was close to 50 feet. And but she's state of the art, and she was built by Jacob Buckout and his son George Buckout. Were the best builders, I guess, at the time. Wouldn't you say, John?
Yes.
Absolutely the best builders. And I fell in love with their kinds of boats. But they built the Jack Frost, and they built the Icicle number 2. And because they were in such competition with each other, these two owners and two sailors, they had the greatest racing. A fellow by the name of Irving Grinnell, who built the Whiff, decided to put a pennant up. A 30-foot long pennant that was called the First Class Challenge Pennant of America for the big boats to run over a 20-mile course on the Hudson River. And in those days, that was a big deal. They'd draw 1,000 people come out and watch this race. And it was raced for from 1881, I believe, all the way until 1922. But the highlight was 1881 to 1902 when they had the big ones. Once they got past that, the big ones couldn't go on the ice too much, for icebreakers were cutting the channel in, and they couldn't get the run. But our club here had two Class 1 ice boats, like the Jack Frost or the Icicle, and we would send two boats up to race against them. Our club was formed in 1880. About 1984, I believe, the Scud was built. And the Scud was built to go up and challenge for that race up there. The Jack Frost was 1883. The Icicle was 1882. We had other big boats up at the time. One was called the Hayes, one was called the Northern Light, all in that time period, all with heavy money backing the boats to build back then, I believe. Now, I'm not totally sure. It was only about $450, $500 back at the 1880s, and that was a lot of money, but they were craftsmen, and these Buckout boats were just phenomenal. And so they made these races go off, and I think it ran off 15 times. Up until 1902. We in Red Bank never won any of those races up there. Five times were won by the Jack Frost, four by the Icicle, we had one by the Great Scott, we had one by the Hayes, one by the Northern Light. I can't remember the rest of them, but after 1902, times changed in our country. Particularly, shipping started to come down that Hudson River, so they cut the channel in pretty good, and when they did that, the boats could not move at width when they had four or five of them together, or six of them together. And the things started to fall apart at that time. And particularly after that time, they did come down here on occasions. 1906, some of them came down here to sail on this river. This river really isn't big enough to pull a race of that magnitude off, but we did have a 1906 race with a rocket of all boats had participated here. Now the rocket, they tell me, when I first came into the club, they had it hidden under the ice boat club, and I was a 17-year-old kid coming in here, and they didn't want me to come and see that boat, and they wouldn't let anybody look underneath. But I made friends with this John Darling, who was our caretaker, and he let me go down and look at it all and learn as much as I could with it. The boat was originally built to run up on the Hudson, however, it never did. And it was left to the club in 1922. And therefore, it was put in storage all those years. And it was just something that was there to defend a certain cup. And the cup is the Venostran cup that the boat was there really to defend. And we never did anything with it. The Venostran cup was put up by Gardner Venostran out of Orange Lake in 1889. And it's a 70 ounces of silver. It's a cup that was relieved for Tiffany's, a beautiful cup. And of all things, the only cup that we won up there was that cup in 1891. And consequently, it's been raced for two times since. I'll refer to that in a few minutes. But that boat, the rocket, was really put there for that reason, but it never materialized. That boat couldn't handle going up, and then it fell on bad times. We had another boat called the Dreadnought. The Dreadnought was a boat that was run by Cap Irwin over here at Irwin's Yacht Works. They were a tremendous family of ice boaters, very good ice boaters, by the way. But again, they couldn't win that race on the Hudson River because this river here is much different, as well as the Long Branch River. The Long Branch Club was built, originated in 1902. And there's a big wide open space over there. There's no hills, like we have hills here. So when you have hills on this ice boat club, the force of effort in the sail is gonna be a little higher. We peak our sails higher if they're gaff riggers, and we seem to run better. On the other river, you got more open spots, and it's a different avenue to race on, and the Hudson is even harder. The Hudson River, the force effort on the sail comes real low. I remember going up there with my Marconi and not doing very well at Orange Lake or any of the Hudson. They have their own style of boat. They're used to tougher ice than we are down here. And it was just a wonderful thing, but you have to have great sailors, and you have to have, there's three different kinds of venues that you go on. You know, even if you go on a lake, it's a little bit different. So it's tougher when you leave this area, go to another area to race. But anyhow, the challenges were cool. We traveled with these boats out of my club. Now, in 1880, after the big boats kind of died, in the turn of 1910, 1920, they were pretty much all gone. The Class 3 boat. I have two models here. This is a Class 3 boat, the smaller one. That was a Class 1. It's missing the jib, but that Class 1 boat is much bigger, as you can see. 50 feet down to 30 or 32 feet on the Class 3. A track of 25 to 30 on the big boat, and a track over here of maybe anywhere from 15 to 20 on the smaller boat. The smaller boats were better because they were easier to handle, and they were more conducive to the sailing conditions that we have here. And they blossomed out. I figure about from the turn of the century on here, we probably had 45 to 50 big boats between this club and the Long Branch Club. I mean, not the big boats, but the small boats. Now, up in the Hudson, they had gone to the smaller boat as well, and then they got smaller. As ice conditions, you need 12 inches of ice for the big boat. The 30 footer, you need about maybe 6 or higher. We like 8. And then they made smaller boats, which would drop down the sail areas. The sail area on the small boat was about 350 square feet. The bigger boat, you're running anywhere from 550 to 1,000. The Rocket, I believe, has 850. And so the performance of the big boat to the little boat. The big boat's like consider it like a bulldozer, out of control bulldozer. You're not gonna stop it too well once it gets rolling. The little boat, you can spill the air out pretty good. So the competition was keen here. We put up a pennant here, actually Long Branch did, it's called the third class pennant of America for the 30 footers. And the Georgie is being restored over in the other club. If you guys wanna go over later, you can see it being restored over there. The Georgie is pictured in that last photograph down at the back end. It was built in 1904 by Cap Irwin's father. And Cap Irwin was the sailor on it. And on the first year, 1904, that 29 starts with that boat, and it won 24 races. And the rest, it came in second or third. So it was probably our best overall boat. She was very small, very docile, and that's turned to be a thing for the future for ice boating. Let's go down, let's get the size down, it's better to use and stuff like that. So that boat sported 350 square feet of sail, but it was 23 feet long, and it was very light. And you had to be a magical sailor to sail that with any kind of experience and expertise. So anyhow, it became one of our best boats, and it still is today if we get it back out. Now it's been going through a restoration, and I'm sure it'll be here. Now Cap Irwin was accused of cheating with that boat on the sail area, because the boat was 23 feet long and everybody else was 30, and they're going, hey, what the heck's going on here? You got too much sail. And if you notice in the pictures, his jib sticks way out past the nose of the boat. So he got angry. And, you know, I guess when you get a captain angry, it's pretty bad. So he took the boat off of competition for 23 years and never came back out. But that boat was built in 1883. And so in 1909, he built a second one, which is a Georgie number 2. And the Georgie number 2 traveled with us up to the Hudson River this past March 1st, and she run like heck, you know, and he just wanted to prove a point. Okay, guys, you think I'm cheating, I'm gonna build another one, and it's gonna be 32 feet long, and it's gonna carry 350 square feet of sail, and it became so fast. And So he proved them all wrong. And then the little boat came back out again and sailed in the second Venostran race that we had. That's for that trophy. We had a race in 1978. That boat came out and sailed and won one of the heats. But ice boating grew all over the place. And we decided that it's better to have something smaller. And then in the 30s, they came out, 1937, they came out with a design of a boat that was 12 feet long called the DN. And they named it on a newspaper article contest, and it came out as the Detroit News newspaper put it on. And out came a 12-foot boat, and it was designated a DN-60. And Phil Tucker is out here. He was a DNer somewhere along in here. But anyhow, it was a fast boat, do 60 miles an hour, and now it's the most prolific boat on the planet. It's all over the world sailing, in the northern countries, obviously. But the competition is so keen. The new boats are so expensive, but the ease of portability, of they put them on airplanes, they fly them overseas, stuff like that. So it really kept the sport alive. There were other modern classes that come up and showed things too, you know, with different variations carrying two people or three people. The lure of the big boat is fantastic. For me, to go on any big boat is the excitement, number one, is this river. This river is the most beautiful river on the planet. I raced Jersey speed skiffs around the country, and I also raced ice boats around the country, and I love this river. The hills are just magnificent. But anyhow, the draw is the lure of that boating, because when you sail these things, I don't care how good a sailor you are, and I am by far not a good one, but that thing will kick your butt when you sail that thing. And you're talking 50 miles an hour, 60 miles an hour, you're 6 inches off the deck, and when she decides that she's gonna throw you off, you're going off. There's no ifs, ands, or buts. And I love the ride on the edge. For me, that's the lure. But you have a sheet tender that's sailing with you, and you can blame everything on him. So he's not letting out the sheet or whatever. On the big boats, when you're sailing a big boat, you have to have her strapped down all the time. You don't wanna get any air in a pocket in the sail, and particularly the jib has to be tended. So they run three people. Somebody runs the jib. Now the smaller boats you can get away with, the helmsman would run the jib as well, and when you turn them, you need somebody on the jib. In the 1978 race, we were out here at Red Bank, and the Jack Frost was in the race and went up to the top mark really doing well, but nobody had a hold of the jib. And all of a sudden, she flickered and spun 360 degrees and threw everybody off. And I happened to be behind them, so I got to see it full hand what it's like to get thrown off of something 50 feet long. But you always have to have that third person. So now you can blame not just the sheet tender, you can blame the jib tender as well. But I love the camaraderie and the people, the experiences of meeting the people that want to help preserve these 100-year-old craft. And everybody helps everybody else. And you know, I remember one time I used to complain because it took me at a race, it would take me 2.5 hours, 3 hours to assemble everybody's boat plus mine. And I said, my God, I'm going to make a trailer that I can assemble my boat in an hour and I'm good to go. Guess what? I forgot I have to help everybody else do theirs. So I'm still up to 2.5, 3 hours. But anyhow, that's what it just brought the sport alive in 1964. The Hudson River Club, I believe their date of incorporation was 1885. They used to be the Poughkeepsie Club. And there was some, I heard there was some sailing refereeing problem, a contested event up on the top stake. And back in the 18, they were, the Poughkeepsie was 1861, their club. And most of those guys were in that club and they decided, wow, there's some kind of problem here. So they formed the Hudson River Club, it was 1885. But really, they all blended together. But the sport took on a new meeting with the big boats. I keep flip-flopping, but I gotta bring it up to you. The big boats brought in the romance of this thing with the money and the high end, the looks and how pretty they were and the money factor back in there and the excitement. It just brought it right up to the Victorian age, and everybody just loved it. I mean, that's what we all lean back on. The glue that holds that ice boat club together and the glue that holds our club together, you and I, is the big boats. The boats have been passed on from generation to generation. It's the boats that holds everything together here, just like it is in this club. They've been passed on from father to son, if that's the case, or when they let them go and let somebody restore them for future generations to see. I said 50 boats were here between the two rivers. I believe there's 32 of them left. So a lot of them stayed here. And the last A-boat that was ever built in the Northeast was a boat called the Vanguard, which I have sailed and I still continue to sail. And the Vanguard was built in 1958 by Pete Wingerter, and it was the fastest A-boat on our rivers here. It was a Marconi-rigged A-boat. Like I said, the Marconis were a different kind of a breed. They were taller, 30, 34 foot high, 36 foot high mast, center efforts way up. When they started being built in our country by Jacob Buckout, again up from Poughkeepsie, he was the best boat builder, these boats were unbeatable. The speeds went way up on these boats, and we had two or three of them here. The challenge pennant of third class was put up by Long Branch, and we were never able to win that again. But once the Marconi rigs came into existence, then we started winning, and we won and won and won with those things. A boat called the Eskimo, and the other one was the Pirate, and they were built in 1939, 37, and they were owned by Jacob Rupert and Gillig, and they were the owners of the New York Yankees. Again, big money people coming in, and they were unbeatable. But that was what really pushed the envelope for speed. And that's what I ended up in. I got pushed over onto the speed side. When Ray Ruge brought iceboating back to America, he brought it back from the wealthy to the commoner and let it become a recreational sport as opposed to one of these things where, you know, it was for the rich and wealthy. And so we were all able, thanks to him, to be able to participate in this sport. But you can get carried away with this like anything else. But here's a picture down here that I cherish. It's the Icicle, a picture of the Icicle with the Jack Frost supposedly running against the train. Those two boats exist today, like I said. And the 1973, the Jack Frost was rebuilt, and I would go up there and help rebuild it. Now, John Spurr came from New York down the opposite way to help rebuild the Rocket. The Rocket took 10 years. That boat took about three years, I believe. Again, they were both similar. The remains of the Jack Frost were found in the beach area, and they had a workaround, a rig. They had an original rig that Rick Aldridge had up at Rokeby. He had it in the sail barn of the original boat. The Icicle is pretty much complete, and that's in the museum, but it will never be used. We had hopes of it being used, but it will never be used because it's an artifact of the Roosevelt campaign. Now, President Roosevelt's uncle ran the Icicle, but President Theodore Roosevelt was an ice boater. His mother bought him an ice boat in 1901. He was a Harvard student at the time, and he sailed it for 4 years. It's up at the Hyde Park Museum, and they let
Franklin.
Yeah, but they let it out for 24 hours, right? Recently, yeah. So that everybody could see it. It's locked away again. It's an artifact, never to be used. As well as the pennant that I talked about, the 30-foot-long pennant from the first class challenge, the big boat challenge, is up there at the museum also. But yeah, that's good. There's other pictures of the boats and stuff. This one model, I got to tell you about this one model. It's so cool. But I love the models. This is an authentic 100-year-old model, or more than 100 years old. And there's a picture of this model on the ice here at Red Bank. A little boy is holding it in his hands. And I was able to purchase this model back in 1970. And I just loved it. It sailed at Central Park. Now, a lot of these owners, a lot of these people were from the New York area and worked in the city. And if they didn't ice boat, where the weathers weren't conditioned to them to get on the ice, they would make a model and they would sail it at Central Park and stuff. That's an actual sailing model. I've sailed it on the river here in about 20 knots of wind. I had a bunch of kids go down river, and I let it loose, and it just goes right on down, and they would fetch it up for me and bring it back. The runners are all done up on it. So this is that old. It's so cool. But that's what they did. You know, they thought ice all the time. And I guess with the setting here in Red Bank, with the paddle wheel boats at the turn of the century and all the way up into the early 20s, and Red Bank was a commercial hub, particularly for tomatoes. They would, you know, come in here and take tomatoes to the city, but they had this beautiful river here, and it was used to the max. They had ice carnivals. There's pictures of ice carnivals here. People would come down, sit in a seat. I think it was a penny to sit there all day, and they put a little pot underneath you with some hot coals to keep your tush warm. So, but sailing out on the ice was something. I've seen as many as 2,000 people on the ice here at Red Bank watching us race, and racing, to me, is the best way to go. And I just love the sport. And Some of these other pictures are Red Bank at the time period, some of the Hudson. Look at them, see some of these famous pictures. But I have a couple of videos I want to show you. But if you have any questions, you know, feel free to ask me. But that's about it. Long Branch, by the way, there was, I got to tell you, a lot of people say speed records. They always talk about speed records. They said the scud on the Hudson River exceeded 109 miles an hour in 1891. Oof. I don't know if I'd want to be on that, baby. I don't know if I'd ever see that. But then it gets better. Over in Long Branch, a boat called the Clarel in 1909 was supposed to have exceeded 142 miles an hour. Three men were timing it on a run. Now, in those days, they ran a triangle course, so there's space out there, but not a lot of space. But I also found out from talking to the old-timers that helped me out that the men that timed her were working in the Rumson Country Club, having some extracurricular beverages. So I don't know if that was a true fact, but 142 miles an hour, who knows? But at any rate, they sailed out of the Rumson Country Club in 1909. They had a tremendous group of people that ran their boats, and they would swap boats out. It was not unusual to have a boat be in Red Bank or Long Branch or Red Bank, or Rumson, and go around the hub. And as long as they were sailing, that's all they believed in, is to sail these things. And that's what we have to do. We're worried about our future, young people wanting to get into the sport. And it's scary to think. We have so many other things at our capabilities, and you know that we want to bring young people in. So anytime a young person comes down here, or anybody in particular, we give them a ride. And we try to give them as much friendliness and take them into the Iceboat Club, CETA. But you know, it's hard to keep somebody interested in it when the ice is not here all the time. You have to travel for the ice. We've traveled as far as Maryland. We've gone to Wisconsin. We've gone everywhere. Jeff Smith just came back from Wisconsin. But that's what you have to do to keep the sport alive. The future of this sport is these old boats that will always draw the people in. And we have to keep them going. And But it's ironic that the day we take the rocket up is March 1st, 2014. And we were up there 11 years prior to that on March 1st in 2004. And I thought that was kind of cool. We never sail in March too much. I think the furthest I've ever gone was March 17th for 1 year. I checked back through all the records of my Iceboat Club and see the temperature ranges and how the averages go. And we always say that we sail somewhere in Red Bank most of the time. I didn't sail last year in Red Bank because we had no ice. But every 10 years or so, we get a blasted winter. And back in 78, that was one of those big winters. We had 31 inches of ice out there. And I have pictures up here of me sailing after the spring had come, pretty much in the spring weather. I was sailing in 70 degree weather on about 8 inches of ice out here because we had that much ice. But in that first or second Finasteride race, we had 17 A boats on the starting line. And I have a video of that standing there watching all 17. And it's incredible to see that many pieces of boats up there. Now, I think we had, 16 or 17 up there on March 1st, and then it grew to stern steers with maybe 25, maybe?
I counted
30. You counted 30, okay.
Said 32.
Isn't that amazing to have that many come out? That had to be the best ever. Huh?
A dozen.
Yeah. But I meant a stern steers, you know.
Stern steers.
Yeah.
30 plus.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah,
probably a few of you. Yeah. There's Bill Camilla back there, like member of the North Shrewsbury, ex-Commodore. Hi, Bill. But yeah, I'm going to tell you, if you ever get an experience to go on it, do it. You're going to love it. Yeah.
Greg, you raised an interesting subject. Is there a real global warming decline as far as the real ice boating ice is concerned?
I don't think so. I think it's been cyclical all that time. I just don't buy into it too much about the global warming side of it. That's part of the thing that we lost interest in. And the ability to ice boat race. I think a couple things factor into when we do get ice here, it takes like 2 weeks to grow. And a lot of times on the third week, you could come out here and we're all like comfortable in our rooms and we don't want to go outside or we got something else going on. So the attraction to ice boating slims down, so you only have the diehards going out. I think the weather's still there. If you travel, yeah, we don't get a lot of snow here, and if we do get a lot of snow, it lays in the ice and freezes up and we get some ice out of it. But I don't know about that. I think it's every 10 years, that's the way it's going to be.
And that's the way it's been, too?
It has. I've looked through the records all the way back in the 1880s.
That's what I was wondering.
Every 10 years is a major big length of time. You ready?
Yep.
Okay.
Look at
that. This is in 2003. So that's me in front of all of it. I tried for 37 years to get on the ice up at the Hudson, and we got them all lined up. Oh, thank you. Now, this was increased double up this past year. There's the Jack Frost. You can see the size of that guy compared to the other ones. There's a Marconi in there and a couple other boats. There's, I think, 15 on the line. You want to skip forward a little bit? You'll see where it's actually sailing, the big boat.
Vanguard.
Yeah, the Vanguard, yeah. I've sailed that Vanguard, and boy, she is one fast. Here, all right, this is sailing. Can you raise the sound? Because it's, I want you to get the sound. You can back this up a little bit. Can you back it up? Because I want to show the height of the sail. All right, I guess you... Anyhow, when you sail the big boats, the sail area is so huge. I've sailed the Jack Frost when it was the original sail, which was about over 800. And now it's down to 650, if I'm not mistaken, on the new sail. That's the new sail right there for the Jack Frost. I wanted to show you the Jack Frost before we get to the rocket, to show you the differences in the boat.
Double-edged runner, run into the other one, and just put them on the spot. Yeah. When we first
ice is very rough up there compared to down here.
I saw them, I fell in love with them back then. They're very black maple also, like the runners on the inward. Yeah. Record it.
Can you fast forward it? See the boat actually sailing. All right, look, this is good. Well, that's like as you jump right to it. Can you back up where the two were together? Sorry. That again is the Marconi. The wind wasn't cooperating, but then it picked up and we were able to go. Why don't you show you the size difference between one of our big A boats and one of theirs? Sail in the middle there is a Rip Van Winkle that Rick Aldridge has, who lives up at Rokeby, that had us come up and sail. She's about 40 foot long?
40
foot.
And the conditions at the Hudson weren't any good?
Well, in that particular day, it was kind of soft ice, but there's a difference between the two big boats. That's one of our A boats there. Oh, that's a rip. Bear with me a minute. He's just trying to hook it up. Here's the size difference. The Jack Frost is on the left.
It is the Rip Van Winkle. Interesting to say. I haven't seen her since 1977. Orange Blink.
The boat on the right is the Now Then from our club, Danny Clapp, who ended up helming the Jack Frost. That's a side railer there. That's the Mary Ellen.
Here we go.
Jack, holy shit.
Sorry about that. But this thing plows through ice, and it was digging in pretty tough, but she was moving.
Wow.
You can hear the ice crunching under there because of the weight. She's about 2,500 pounds. And it was only pushing about maybe 5 or 7 knots winds. Now some of the newer boats, the Skeeters, are so well designed. They're the fastest in the world. On a light wind, say 7 knots of wind, they can do 10 times the speed of the wind. That big boat there is able to get maybe 3 at the most, maybe 4. But the newer boats today could exceed 100. I don't believe any A boat, although it could come close. I think they're all in the 70-mile range or 80-mile range for the top end. There's so much sail area here.
How much was the sail you guys were making for sail? That's the point. You never get that price of sail.
She'll pick up speed pretty quick. You shake and bake back there. There's a term, shiver my timbers. When the old boats were so thick, the runner planks were so thick, your eye teeth would bang, and you'd be really, every bone in your body would shake. That's the Marconi, the Vanguard next to it. I'm trying to hold a camera and she tended at the same time. It's pretty tough. Now the speeds the rocket ran this past March were much faster. That's the Rhinecliff Bridge there, Kingston Rhinecliff Bridge. They sailed under it this year. I think one of the boats went all the way down the river to Kingston, and then I think some of them went as much as 20 miles. The ice was so thick. Look at it, when it panned, that camera panned up to the top of the sail, how much sail area is up there. Does she what? Hike over? Yeah, they'll hike. Yeah. Do you feel hear the wind going in the... You have to experience it to see how cool it is. A lot of the videos we made this year up at the Hudson didn't... have that audio. That is a lateen rig. These lateen, that's the last one in existence that's still sailing. That was a Roosevelt boat. And the lateens were on the Long Branch River and the Red Bank River. Look at panning up to that big sail there. All right, you can stop this one. Yeah, my wife's gone faster than I have in an ice boat, just by accident, with the gentleman that was sailing with me in the jack. She got caught in a snow squall one day, and I said, who's that fool out there sailing by? And it was my wife. But, on the spot, he says. Okay, we're going to try another video real quick to show here at Red Bank. And then we have the Edison tape, but I don't know if you guys want to see that or not.
Greg, how often did the rocket actually come out? How many seasons?
Back in the days?
In total, yeah.
We don't know.
Don't know, but it wasn't very much used, actually.
Well, here's... The man who owned it was a name by the name of Cooley. And he was one of the founding members of our Iceboat Club. And he had a lot of money, I guess, and built that boat. We don't know where the boat was built. I do know that the Scud number 1 was built up by the Merrick brothers up in Chelsea, New York. The second boat, I believe, was built here in Fairhaven. And it was built by a man by the name of Chandler. I do believe the rocket was built by the same man. There's a big difference between our boat and the Jack Frost. There's a big difference. And I do believe that they were built locally. I know I have read articles where the Scud was taken out of Fairhaven and sailed, and the crew wanted to abandon ship because there was not enough room on that ice out there in Red Bank to handle it. How many times it was ever used? I know only one time that I've actually seen photographs, and that was 1906 against a boat called the Hayes out of, and the Northern Light out of the Hudson right here at this river. I don't know other times than that. We had to have a foot of ice to go do it, and with no snow and great conditions. Maybe not, maybe not. I want you to look at this one. It shows the Bonostran race that we had in 78. The second running, we had 21 stern steers, I guess. There's the lineup right here. And let's see. This is our river there. There's Grange Avenue in the background. And we're all lining up. The breeze is pretty stiff. And this is where the Jack Frost lost control and spun out because nobody had the jib. We had a heck of a line of boats there. And sailing, you got to know the right-of-ways with these things and the speeds, the closing speeds on them. It's pretty difficult. You know, you got guys going upwind, guys coming downwind. There's the Latine rig that's still there, the reed. I'm in the next boat, which was originally a cat rig buckout boat, and I converted it to a boom and gaff. But there's the lineup. It was pretty cool. Channing Irwin here, I think, wins the this first race, I believe. But we had Reuben Snodgrass, his name, he was out of Long Island, Lake Ronkonkoma, in a 42-foot boat called the Cold Wave. That's Channing Irwin in that first boat there. That's that Georgie that's so quick. And we could have lost this race very easily, but we ended up, it was a three-race series. But those were the conditions that particular day. And I think it was blowing about, 14 or 15 miles an hour. You know, a lot of stuff wasn't documented, but I had enough insight to bring a camera and let somebody operate it for me. And I took pictures from inside the boat during the race. I was always keen on the history of this sport. You got guys coming on. Iceboating came back alive in the 60s. And it's really going strong now. I'm so faithful that it's going to hang in there. But that was the biggest gathering of A-boats since last 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, that we ever had. Here's the Jack Frost, and we went out on a ride with our wives here. But we had a man sitting on a runner plank with a camera so he could video this. And this, ironically, was the last class one to ever sail on our river. And this was 1978. And then hopefully we'll get the Rocket to be the next one to come out. We technically should be wearing helmets out here, but we let the girls go on without helmets. They're smarter than me. Anyhow, this is looking up that sail. This is the original sail that was about 900 square feet. Look at the mast on this thing. It's getting up there, 35, 45 now, miles an hour.
There are in total three big boats, right? There's the Rocket, Jack Frost, and a third. Out there still, right?
Well, we have the Icicle, yeah. That's it's in the museum.
Oh, okay. No,
but out west they have bigger boats, but they're modern. They're pretty modern. There's the Deuce out there at 55 or 60 feet long.
So there are only two of this type sailing?
Two sailing, yeah. Our dream was to have the third one sail. It may come true. But the federal government has something to say about it in the state of New York. They think it's an artifact. Look at the size of that sail up there, would you? I took it for a ride one day on Orange Lake, and it took me 45 minutes to stop it. Every time I came around, the wind would get inside that great big sail and take off again. I had a girl riding with me that had no coat, so she was really happy. That's how much wind's there that day. But there's a day that I was telling you about when it was 70 degrees out, and it's going to be in the next part of this video. And the Marconi was very fast that I built and owned, and here it is here. This is state of the art for ice boats. It was
I could hike this thing up. It's 70 degrees, and I'm sailing on a layer of water. And she's just riding up. You ask me if they healed over, there you go. I could hang that thing forever up there.
Where'd you make that sail?
I built it in 1970, the sail and the mast. It's a 16-inch wide mast. I tried to go after the major speed like the guys out in the Midwest did, Wisconsin area. The mast was 36 feet high. The boat was 34. But she was very, very quick. Jack Melville from Fairhaven was my sheet tender here. But this boat almost killed me one time. We broke through the ice. You can cancel it there. And I trapped under the ice out here, and it was pretty bad. I can't swim, so I was going to try to. I've raced boats all my life, and I can't swim. So, when you look like you're going into ice, you know, there's two things that go through your mind: is I got to get out of here. So I jumped, and jumping wasn't a good deal. You have a 50-50 shot of making it on top of the ice or under the ice. Well, I made it under the ice, so. That was pretty bad, but Jack, my sheet tender, that's another thing of having a crew with you. He hung in there and stayed with me as I was locked up underneath the ice there. But it put a fear in me a little bit, but not enough to make me dislike the sport. So I was right back. And ironically, like anything else, when the horses get out of the barn, you close the doors. The next race, I had a life jacket on. I took it off though. But anyhow, things you remember. Okay, that's my two. You want to do the Edison video, or I don't know if you guys have time for that? Or you want to go take a break?
We'll take a break.
Okay. Thank you so much. Yeah.